a scale of 1 to 10, that Todd McClellan was fired wasn't the shocking thing, right? Like, on a scale of 1 to 10, to see Ken Hitchcock get into Edmonton, how would you rank that in your opinion?
It was a big surprise, but I have to tell you, I was annoyed at myself for not at least thinking about the possibility, because the one thing I think we all suspected was that if Edmonton was going to make a coaching change, it wasn't going to be for futures. It was going to be for somebody who they thought could change the momentum now. There's simply too much on the line in this particular season. And as I was going through the list of guys and thinking, okay, who could be this person, could be this person, could be this person, Joel Quenneville obviously comes to mind, a few other guys, Alain Vigneault, I was annoyed that I didn't think of Hitchcock, just because even though, quote unquote, he was retired, he's a coach. He wants to be a coach. He has no desire to be a consultant. He wants to be behind the bench for as long as he can be behind the bench. And the fact that he wasn't doesn't mean he still didn't want to get back there. So when the news first broke yesterday, I was shocked. Then the more I thought about it, I was saying to myself, you're an idiot for not at least considering the possibility.
Man. The man had retired.
Wait a minute,
free.
Man. No, come
too
on,
hard
man.
On the man had Holy. Walked away.
Elliot, listen.
No. Guys, like, he wants to coach. Sorry, I just find myself $5 more for saying like. He wants to coach, and he is a coach. He craves it. He loves it. It's what he wants to do. We should have seen it coming.
All right, fair enough.
At least the possibility of it.
Fair enough.
So him, like a couple other scenarios this year, like he may not be coaching for long, very interim deal right now, possibility to revisit at the end of the season. We're seeing that trend kind of come to the forefront in the NHL this year. Why is that the case? Why are interim coaches more popular now than somebody coming in to replace more permanently and establishing something before the season ended?
It is a change, and there's a couple of reasons. First of all, Joel Quenneville was making $6 million this year and $6 million next year. And the two assistant coaches that they let go, Kevin Dean and L. Samuelson, were making about $1 million combined each both season. Now, they did commit to Jeremy Culleton long term. It's the Blackhawks say that he is their coach. But if you look at Edmonton, Todd McClellan was $3.5 million this year and next. And I think it was simply a situation where they look at it and say, we just want to do a test drive here to make sure that this is going to work and is the right fit for us. And the reason is coaches' salaries have been booming. Mm-hmm. The coaches have done really well in hockey, and I say more power to them. I'm a big believer in everybody should get as much as they possibly can negotiate for themselves. But if you're a team and all of a sudden you've got this big severance, even if you're a high revenue team like Edmonton is, you don't want to have to sit there and say, okay, we're going to commit another big number to someone else when we've already got close to $7 million we have to pay this particular guy. So I do think that's a factor. Also, if Edmonton doesn't make the playoffs, there could be big changes, and you might want whoever's next in charge to pick their own particular coach. There's a lot of things that go into that, but what I think the number one thing is that they're understanding that the cost of your mistakes or things that don't work out are much greater than ever. And number two, Faisal, I think there's a big debate going on, not only in hockey, but everywhere in life, of how do we reach and communicate with the next generation, mm-hmm. whether you call them millennials or Generation Z, I don't know what we're calling them this week, but it's a situation where you have to understand that this new age person, young and in their 20s, how do you communicate with them? And hockey's no different. And there's a number of these teams are talking to more and more younger coaches or coaches that have experience dealing with younger players, because they say these are the people we have to reach and make them perform for us.
Fridge, speaking of millennials, there's a millennial with the Leafs that Kyle Dubas is having some issues with.
That's pretty good.
Thank you. I get broken clock is right twice a day. Just ask Sam. Sam knows the show. So what do we look for tonight with the Canes and Leafs here, Fridge? Because the Canes have been linked, but a lot of people have been linked. 10 days to go to Nylander. Where do we stand in the story, and what should we be watching for tonight, if anything?
If Kyle Dubas and Don Waddell had any sense of humor, they would watch this game together.
Absolutely.
Could you imagine?
Absolutely.
Could you imagine what that would do if they sat the whole game right next to each other? Look, I'm sure they're talking. Look, when you have negotiations, sometimes it goes better face-to-face than it does, you know, texting or talking on the phone or whatever. I really think that, first of all, the number one question on Nylander is Carolina, if he wants the final number to be around 7 million, is Carolina prepared to do that when they've also got to do Aho, they've also got to do Teravainen, and they've also got to do Ferland? I think that's a big question. The other thing is, Brett Pesce's name has been out there a lot. I don't believe that's what Toronto wants to get this done. They want the nugget, the true gold nugget, and that is Slavin. And I'm not convinced Carolina wants to do that. So, you know, if these two sides are, if those two things are unwilling to be worked on or compromised upon, I'm not sure we have a deal here. But I have no doubt they're interested. I believe the organization would love to get Nylander. But number one, you got to be willing to pay him what he wants. And number two, you got to be able to make a trade for him unless you're going to offer sheet him. And if you're Carolina and you're sitting there and you could miss the playoffs, do you want to risk giving up a lottery pick, a high lottery pick potentially, for Nylander? There's a lot of teams who are scared of that kind of thing.
You got about 30 seconds. Does this go to 5 p.m. Eastern, November 30th?
God, I hope not.
I'm kind of with you.
We're in player fold now, right?
Yeah.
We're finally getting there.
Yeah.